Morning, family. My name is Dylan Harding. I actually lead the team ministry for our church here in Orange County. It's an honor to be able to preach to you guys this morning. I know I'm 18 years old, but amen, I can still preach God's word. I love Sammy's welcome, you know, because he talked about children, you know, and he talked about how, you know, what children desire. Well, I mean, he desires a WWE figure. But I think you think about it, right? Like when a child wants something, you know, it's going to do whatever it takes to get it from its parents. You know, they'll go to whatever length that they got to take to be able to get what they want from their parents. Yes. They honestly get a little sold out, you know, just to get what they want. And you know, I kind of asked Jerry, like, what's something that we should really hear today, you know? And it revolved around the topic of quiet times. And what I think is today we're going to look at an incredible passage of a child of God who actually begged God for what they wanted, what they needed, and what they desired most. And we're going to look at the story of the Canaanite woman. And if you guys can turn with me to Matthew chapter 15, that's where we're going to start off. You know, it's incredible because in this passage, there's three things that this woman does, you know, to get what she wants from God. And from those three things, I made three short points for you guys this morning. But the title of my lesson is called The Faith of the Canaanite Woman. And we're going to be picking it up here in verse 21. Once again, it's Matthew chapter 15, and we're going to start in verse 21. And here's what it reads. Leaving that place, Jesus withdrew to the region of Tyre and Sidon. A Canaanite woman from that vicinity came to him, crying out, "Lord, Son of David, have mercy on me. My daughter is demon-possessed and suffering terribly." You know, what's funny about these two verses is that it doesn't even say who this woman is. You know, it's just a random woman who comes up to Jesus and she has some hardship in her life. She has a daughter that is demon-possessed. And something that I noticed here is that even though she comes up to Jesus with this hardship, she has to ask Jesus to have mercy on her. You know, and you think when there's somebody who asks to ask for mercy, it's probably because there might be a little bit of sin in their life. Yeah. And so really what I'm getting here is that basically this is a sinful woman who is asking God to give her what she wants. And you know, I can relate to this. I'm a pretty sinful person and I can ask God for a lot. But I think her approach to Jesus to have her daughter being healed is something that is really admirable. And I think that first approach is what we're going to look at. And my first point for you guys this morning is you've got to see your need for God. You know, and we're going to break down this whole passage a little verse by verse so we can really understand what goes on here. And once again, we're going to read in verse 22 again down to verse 24. And it reads, "A Canaanite woman from that vicinity came to him crying out, 'Lord, Son of David, have mercy on me. My daughter is demon-possessed and suffering terribly.' Jesus did not answer a word. So his disciples came to him and urged him, 'Send her away, for she keeps crying out after us.' He answered, 'I was sent only to the lost sheep of Israel.'" Wow. So you see, this woman comes to Jesus with the request of him healing her demon-possessed daughter. Now I've never seen a demon-possessed person before. But the Bible has told some pretty intense stories about what it looks like for someone to be demon-possessed. You know, and even when we're talking about children, you know, I mean, there are some pretty evil children out there. I'm not going to lie. But this woman's daughter was actually demon-possessed, though. You know? And there are some accounts of children who are actually demon-possessed in the Bible. And there's one particularly of this young boy who was demon-possessed. And this demon that was inside of him would throw him into fires and would try to drown him. And the fact that that's the kind of demon possession that this young girl had, I can imagine what her mother must have been going through. To have to see her daughter be demon possessed, that's petrifying. And you see that in the scripture here, it says that she comes to Jesus crying out to him. You know, and I'm a pretty ugly crier. I try not to cry too often in front of people. But, you know, crying is like kind of like that word, like we can imagine what that looks like when you think of someone crying. But it's like what does crying out really mean? Yeah. You know, and specifically just talking from the Bible, I wanted to get the Bible's perspective on what it means to be crying out to someone. And you know, the Greek word for crying actually is kerazo. And this word literally means I shriek, I scream, or I cry out. So what this scripture is saying is that this woman was literally screaming in shrieks, crying out to Jesus to heal her daughter. And what does it say that Jesus did? It says he didn't answer a single word. I'd be pretty ticked off. But the funny thing is that the disciples heard it. Is that her screaming not only reached Jesus, but it reached the disciples. And I've never heard is that the disciples were actually annoyed from all the screaming she was doing. Like, they were telling Jesus, like, do you need to send her away? Like, I'm tired of all her screaming and nagging. And yet all this screaming was meant to produce, you know, for Jesus to heal her daughter. Yeah. Right. And something that really sticks out to me is that God will put hardship in your life for you to finally see your need for God. Yeah. You know, and if God is the one who puts the hardship in your life, He is the only one that can take it out of your life. And the moment that we try to fix the hardship that He puts in our life, only something that Jesus or God Himself can fix, we're only going to find ourselves in more pain. And I really admire this woman's begging, because she was begging in such a way of tears, of weeping. And you know, for me, you know, I actually got to be able to preach at our teen leadership program at Ignite a couple months ago. And really, I vowed that every single day I was never going to miss a quiet time for this whole year. And I've carried it out faithfully, but I realized that there's something else that I've had to add on to, you know, to my relationship with God, which is this kind of prayer. You know, and my prayer is that you guys will join me in praying in such a way that not only begs God, but it's in a way of being faithful and knowing that He can do it. Yeah. And to have that same faith like the Canaanite woman. And you know what's crazy is that finally, you know, after all the screaming and after all the shrieks and agony, you know, Jesus finally says something. And what he says, I was only sent to save the lost sheep of Israel. Woo! I can't imagine what my mom would have done if that's what her Jesus response was to her. But I think the fact that after all this screaming, right, after all the shrieks, that she realized that that wasn't enough to grasp Jesus' attention. That she had to step it up. She had to add something more to her begging for Jesus to heal her daughter. And which brings me to my second point, which is you've got to kneel before God. And we're going to read in verse 25 what happens next. In verse 25, it says, the woman came and knelt before Him. Lord, help me, she said. And what's crazy here is that the one way that she decides to step up her level of begging God is that she gets on her knees before Him, right? And to kneel before someone, it's a very humbling thing. And I realized something, maybe you guys have caught this as well, but in this passage, this is the second time that she has now called Jesus Lord, right? She hasn't called Him anything else but Lord. And I think it's because it is the type of relationship that she had towards Jesus and the respect that she has for Him.
Yeah.
Which is that Jesus is her Lord, is her master, and that she is her slave. You know, and I think that kind of relationship is one that needs to be admired. You know, that respect, the reverence for God. And I think that's the kind of relationship that we have to learn how to begin with in our relationship with Jesus, which is that Jesus, He is our Lord, He is our master, and that we are His slaves and workers.
Right.
And you know, there's one other person, not the only person, in the Bible that I know that has this same exact relationship, that has this respect, and has this general reverence for God. And that was Jesus Himself. You guys don't have to turn there, but in Matthew chapter 26 and verse 39, it talks about Jesus literally fell flat on His face and prayed before God.
Yeah.
And this was at a key point in Jesus' life when He had to come to the realization that He was going to die. That He lived 33 years of His whole life on earth, and that now it's time for Him to die. This is a big hardship that He had to learn how to overcome. But He knew that the only way He could do that was through God. Yeah. And He decides to lay flat on His face and pray to God for 3 hours. That's intense.
Yeah.
And you think, right? If Jesus can lay flat on His face and pray to His dad, we can do the same, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
And what I love is, I remember one time, it was really funny, my dad decided to get a bunch of the disciples from the central region. It's a church that we have in Pasadena. And you guys know who Joey Gregory is, right?
Oh, yeah.
He's an incredible brother. I remember he was at the place too. My dad invited all his disciples to come over to our house. And it was kind of just like a time of like fellowship, to kind of like discipling one another. And I remember right before the night ended, what my dad wanted to do is he's like, all right, guys, before we even think about going to bed, we're going to get on our knees and pray. And you know, at the time, that wasn't something that was very normal to do, which is to get on my knees and my forearms and pray. And I could see the seriousness that my dad had in his eyes about why he needed to get on his knees. And I mean, most of you guys know what my dad is, and his knees are not the best. And for him to get on his knees to pray, that means a lot. There is a seriousness, you know, to the reason why, because he knew that he needed it. And in the same way, you know, it's really cool because we all sat in a little circle and we each individually prayed on our knees to God. It was an incredible experience. And what's cool is that on Facebook, there's still a little picture of all of us in a circle. But I think, like, that's the same approach that this woman had to Jesus. She says that she knelt before God to get on her knees, probably in the dirt, and to beg him with. And the funny thing is that she didn't just stop screaming and shrieks. No, this is something she added on to it. So she was begging God and she was screaming for him to heal her daughter. You know, and taking a demon out of someone isn't easy. You know, you see in the Bible, like, even the disciples didn't have faith at one point to draw out a demon out of a child. So you think, right, this woman who probably has sin in her life, she probably isn't a disciple, and she's trying to take a demon out of her daughter. That only comes to a point when you have to realize that only Jesus can take this demon out of her daughter. And I think that's something I need to even bring more into my relationship with God. And something that I want to start doing even just this week and the weeks to come, and if you guys, I pray you guys will join me as well, is that I want to start the day on my knees, and I want to end the day on my knees, praying to God. And I thank you. And imagine what God is going to do in our ministries when we have this same level of begging, when we're getting on our knees, when we're screaming out to God, like this Canaanite woman on a day-to-day basis. And you think, after both of these things that she begins to do, there's one last thing that this woman does that gets her what she wants. And the one thing that she wants is her daughter to be freed from this demon. And I'll tell you, if you're a mom and dad here, if you ever saw your child or even your daughter or your son in pain, you would do whatever it took to heal them. There's not a single thing in this entire planet that would stop you from making sure that your daughter or your son was safe. And this woman was probably in the same position. And let's see what she does in the next verse, in verse 26. My third point is you've got to use the scriptures for God. In verse 26, it reads, he replied, it is not right to take the children's bread and toss it to the dogs. Yes, it is, Lord, she said. Even the dogs eat the crumbs that fall from their master's. Wow. This woman had some guts. The fact that Jesus used God's own word to tell her, you know, like, hey, look, I don't think it's really right for me to, you know, to pass some bread that's not for me. What she decides to do, because she has some knowledge of the Bible, she decides to use the scriptures to persuade Jesus into giving her what she wanted. And she didn't twist the scriptures, but she was able to use the scriptures in such a way as to get what she wanted. And that blows my mind, because I honestly think that sometimes God just wants us to remind him of the promises that he's given us.
Yeah.
You know? And the reason that he does this is so that he can see that we truly understand the promises that he's given us. And I can tell you this, God isn't going to bless someone who does not understand his promises. Which is why it's all the more eager, because now we got to bring and read in the Bible into the picture. You know, that reading the Bible in a way of not just reading it over and learning this stuff, but really examining it to break it down, to understand these different scriptures and the promises that he has for us. And you know, I think, what are some scriptures that we know about asking God for things? You know, not, we know about, maybe some of you guys know Matthew 7:7-8, you know, ask and you'll receive. You know, a great one is even Jesus, Luke 11:1-4. You know, he talks about literally Jesus explaining what prayer is. But I think, like, what's the prayer? What's the scripture that really gets you in the mood to talk to God? And, you know, a scripture that really helps me out and it really speaks a lot to me when I think about, you know, asking God for what I want. I think of John chapter 16, if you guys can please turn there with me. In John chapter 16, in verse 23, the scripture reads, in that day, you will no longer ask me anything. Very truly, I tell you, my Father will give you whatever you ask in my name. Until now, you have not asked for anything in my name. Ask and you will receive, and your joy will be made complete. Wow. You see, what this scripture is saying, you know, because we have to understand it, is that when we ask things in Jesus' name, he says it's going to be given to us. And if we have these promises, if Jesus says if we ask for these promises, he's going to give it to us. And when we see these promises that are fulfilled in our life from asking God for what we want, the scripture says that our joy will be made complete. And we have to learn how to use these scriptures in such a way as to get what we want from God. You know, it's not enough to just be able to read it, but to really understand it so that we can prove to God that we know what the parables, we know what these promises are, so that he can give us what we want. You know, and my challenge to you guys is very, very simple. By the end of this week, I challenge you guys to really dig deep in the Bible and to really look for your prayer scripture. Look for that scripture, that particular section, or maybe that little passage that really gets you into the mood of prayer. And then what I want you to do is then I want you to examine the scripture. You got to break it down. You got to really understand it. The Bible is written in two different languages. Maybe even it's in Hebrew and in Greek. So you got to really, like, really, what is the scripture talking about? Examine it, understand it. And then what I want you to do is then I want you to use the scripture the next time you pray.
Yeah.
That when you pray, you use the scripture and you learn how to use it to persuade Jesus into giving you what you want.
Come on, bro.
And you think, after all of these things that she does, and I'm closing out here, and all of these three things that she did, that she cried out to Jesus, that she got on her knees, and then she used the scriptures to persuade Jesus into giving her what she wanted. Let's see what the result was after she did all these three things. And in the last verse, turn back to Matthew chapter 15. In verse 28, it reads, "Then Jesus said to her, 'Woman, you have great faith. Your request is granted.' And her daughter was healed at that moment." Wow. So not only did she ask Jesus to heal her daughter and he did it, she had faith that he could do it as well. That despite the fact that even all these different things in the background that could have caused her to lose faith, that even the disciples couldn't do it. The disciples didn't want her to be screaming out to heal her daughter. The fact that she had to go through all these things, she knew that Jesus could do it. And you know, I think that relates to us today, because we have to realize that when we get these hardships in our life, when these things are to come, we must realize that Jesus is the only way for your problems to be solved. You know, for me, I'm a very, very prideful person. And at times when things get hard in my life, with the moment that things start to go downhill, I start to take control. And what I begin to do is I begin to think of all these different scenarios of how I'm going to solve this problem, how I'm going to take all these different things that I have jumbled up, put it together, and try and figure my way out. And it never works. Not a single time has it ever worked for me. And yet, what really does work is when God has to put you through that for you to see that I'm the only answer, I'm the only way that you can truly overcome this. And this woman had to do that. That she knew that Jesus was the only way that she could overcome and get this demon out of her daughter. And today, if we want God to answer our requests, if we want to learn how to use God in our life to be able to overcome the problems, the trials, and the hardships, there's three things that we must do to add into our relationship with God. One, you've got to cry out to God.
Yeah.
Two, you've got to kneel before God. And three, you've got to use the scriptures for God. Because just like the Canaanite woman, we will have great faith and we will see God grant our request. Thank you for letting me share.